a very different view of Jerusalem. We're on the crest of the Mount of Olives, joining Mount Scopus here near Hebrew University, near the World Lutheran Federation Tower. And we're looking at Jerusalem before dawn, before sunrise. So you see the big tower of the Franciscans, and that's a very important landmark because that also identifies where Notre Dame is, just across the street. And maybe we can see it better without that olive tree there. You can also see the King David Hotel and the YMCA Tower. And then the Franciscan Tower of the Church of the Savior, which is illuminated. And there you have Notre Dame. So instead of looking from Notre Dame over this direction, we're now looking in the opposite direction. But there's another surprise coming for you right now. So let's walk further east over the crest of the hill and let's see what we can see. I haven't been there yet, so I'm not sure. I hope you can hear me because of the longer hike, I have different gear on and I forgot to take the microphone. So we'll get away from the cars a little bit and then there should be less background noise and you should be able to hear me, I hope. We're starting a little early because I have a good walk back from this point. But also we can have very worthwhile observations up here. Right here you can see the Tower of Hebrew University. We never had it that close on a sunrise stroll. And there's the tower of the World Lutheran Federation, Augusta Victoria, with that extraordinary cancer facility there, cancer treatment facility. And this is Hebrew University here, co-founded by a childhood hero of mine, Einstein, and then many other famous Jewish scientists, mostly from the Western world, from Europe and America. And now we're looking out here on the desert. But there's a tremendous amount of cloud, so that's affecting our visibility. You can see signs of sunrise coming there on the verge of that cloud in the center of the screen. So here we're on quite a viewpoint. Let me fix up the tripod here and then you'll have a little more comfort. There's more stability with the picture. So the cloud has hampered our expectation, my expectation. I thought we'd see a lovely sunrise coming over the mountains of Moab, which we can't even see because of the haze. The weather's getting warmer here. And in Galilee today, I think it's in the mid 30s of Celsius. So that's pretty warm. That's in the 90s, you know, way up in the 90s. So much man proposes and God disposes. You know, we had this proposition here to be here this morning so early for a nice sunrise, and the Lord gave us this type of cloud. But that's okay. Moses was looking in from Mount Nebo and he didn't get to cross over. So we often have these experiences in life when we have a cherished goal and expectation and it doesn't get fulfilled right away. So we're looking out on the Judean desert. And already here you can see where we have a lot of trees. Obviously, they're probably a little bit helped here by the presence of the university. And over here at Augusta Victoria and this complex over here, which also houses the German Archaeological Institute. Very good friend there. Just listen to this. Dr. Dieter Viehwegen. Viehweger. Three doctorates. You know, if you get a doctorate in Germany, it's not enough. You need to have two at least to be somebody. And if you have three, then you're kind of, you know, important. He's a wonderful man. And he is a great archaeologist. And there's one site in Jordan which he was leading the dig, and he made a plan for 400 years to excavate it. An organized, rational plan. And on the part he was doing, he had 8 students doing doctorates on the little section that he was doing at the moment. This was a number of years ago. He's also a great pedagogue. He has written wonderful programs for children to be introduced to archaeology. So I haven't seen him for quite a while. Maybe we'll get there someday to catch up again. So here we have this view into the Judean desert. Now, I was commenting about the trees. So I mentioned this the other day, that the moisture is coming not from the east, but from the west, from the Mediterranean, right? And we're looking now to the east. We're looking over towards Mesopotamia, really. Iraq, Iran, Babylon. Hey, you don't like that, Mr. Crow? What are you trying to tell me? What? So the rise up here on the Mount of Olives for the clouds means it gets a little chillier, and so they drop the moisture that they still have. And what comes here east of the Mount of Olives is practically nil. It's very little. And as far as I understand, there are two types of desert. Here, this first part that's higher up is called a Syrian-style desert. And then further down, when it gets completely brown, it's called Saharan-type desert. There's also a wonderful couple here from California. They've been here for decades running biblical school. And this gentleman, I'm trying to think of his name, that's terrible. And he was explaining to us one day how here you have an intersection of, I think it's 5 or 6 different botanical regions between here and Jericho. So you have the desert, you have the steppe, the Asian steppe coming in through Syria. So you have botany from that region, and you have the Saharan type of vegetation, the Saharan desert type with the minimum vegetation it would have. And then you have the Mediterranean rim, because we're only an hour away from the Mediterranean here if you didn't have traffic. And then you have the savanna coming up through the Nile, and some of that vegetation is present in the Jordan Valley in the Jericho area. So it's almost like a center of the world also botanically, which is very interesting. I found that interesting at least. So this is as much of the sunrises you're seeing here from the top of the Mount of Olives. So we're going to have to come back someday and see this again. So I don't anticipate much progress here. Maybe there will be. And I was thinking we could head back towards Jerusalem. The readings we have today are very interesting. We have Peter at the Temple Mount, so we'll hold on that until we get back a little further. And we have the two disciples in Luke 24 who are walking away from Jerusalem, like I did now. When I walked east, they were walking west according to the geographical memories we have. There are different candidates for the place of Emmaus. And then Kathleen presented one of those in the pilgrimage there, towards the end of the pilgrimage. Emmaus Latrun. And that's a long walk, that's the furthest away. And then there's Kubebe in the West Bank and Abu Ghosh, which are about equidistant from Jerusalem. And then there's the town of Moza. And there's a theory that it could be there, although that seems to be half the distance that's given in the biblical account. But if you add the half going and coming, then you'd have your distance. But those are all speculations. So there are places where the memory seems to have been kept of the story of Emmaus. And these two disciples are very sad. They're walking along alone. It's Easter Sunday. And it's a very intriguing conversation they have with a stranger who catches up with them along the way as they're walking. So he says, "You look sad. What's up?" And they say to him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem?" Stranger, somebody that doesn't live around here. "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who is completely unclued about what's going on? Like what happened this weekend? You know, it's not every day you have capital punishment and crucifixions, and it's Passover, so there were lots of people from outside the city come for the feast day, right?"
Look at that beauty.
We have lots of them over here.
Look at the design. The color scheme. The delicacy.
Fascinating. Nature is fascinating. I think we'll come back another day for more of the Mount of Olives, okay, folks? God willing. So, we're leaving Hebrew University area now. So he said to them, "What things? What's going on?" Kind of didn't get it, you know? And they said to him, "Well, about Jesus of Nazareth, like, you ever heard of him? And he was mighty indeed, and incredible words coming from his mouth." And here we have a jogger out in the early morning. See, Jerusalem is a normal place. Oops, sorry about that, people. Uh-huh. Good morning.
Good morning.
You were on live stream there.
Nice day.
God bless you. I just hit the wall there with the tripod, which is hanging parallel here, horizontal. So, sorry about that. I jerked the phone. I hope you didn't lose connectivity. So then they start to tell him about this fellow who got in trouble with the authorities. There was a lot of tension, and they ended up trying him and handing him over to the Romans, who crucified him. And some women told us that they were at the tomb and his body was not there. So this is the data that these people have in their brain and that they're sharing with this stranger who's walking alongside them. So do you recognize anything, people? This is a different view of the Dome of the Rock from high up on the Mount of Olives. Well, actually, on this little gap between the Mount of Olives and Mount Scopus. And then if we scan across the city, there you have Mount Zion almost lined up with the Dome of the Rock, as we're seeing it from this perspective. Mount Zion is there in the center of the screen with the Domitian Abbey dominating. And then you have to the right of the Domitian Abbey that white dome of the Hurva Synagogue. The burned synagogue, which has been restored. And then you have the King Solomon Hotel there in the center, and then the King David Hotel, the YMCA Tower, the Franciscan Tower, and right beside it, Notre Dame, look. So yesterday, or other days, we were watching the sunrise from Notre Dame, and today we're on the other side of Jerusalem. And there you see the high rises of Western Jerusalem. If you abstract all those, that new development the last 50 years out of the picture, then you can see how Notre Dame was a major feature in the Jerusalem skyline from the 1870s until the 1950s. It would have been a dominating piece in the view from the Mount of Olives, just like those towers are dominating now. Those high rises. I'm just going to park here for a second so you can see this for another moment, because then we won't have the same view again. This will be the bird's eye view we'll have today of Jerusalem, in case you want to get a screenshot or two. Let me get that together for you. There you go. I just spotted another feature that I'll show you in a moment. Mandra. The Hill of Joy. So let's swing around a little bit here just to capture more of the city there. Also, the other day when we did the evening stroll, the afternoon stroll along Jerusalem, I'll let me show you the view from here of the Rockefeller Museum. We walked by there on that street. There you have the Rockefeller Museum. So the old city, if you draw a line from the Rockefeller to the Franciscan Tower, more or less, or to Notre Dame, that's the northern side of the old city. We're on the eastern corner, a little north of the line, but almost on the north of the line of the old wall. And then you have, on this side here is the eastern side. And across from us on the other side, from Notre Dame and the Franciscan Tower, then over to the Domitian, to Mount Zion, is the western side of the city. And then the southern side of the wall, that area is not in view right now. Okay, well, ready? Let's go. This is a nicely developed park here on the side of the Mount of Olives. And I think I got a good dose of pollen this morning coming up here, because it activated my sinuses. I remember when they were planting it and putting it in about 10 years ago. They redid it and put in pathways and stairs, so we'll go along there now. Look at that. The sun is still covered by the cloud. It's probably going to emerge soon, but it's no longer the fresh sunrise. All these trees are in bloom as well here. This road takes you down to the Mormon University, the extension of Brigham Young University. And they have a nice view over Jerusalem from here. Shalom. Here you have a map for your orientation. We're doing live stream here, Shidur Hai.
What?
Doing Shidur Hai.
Not Shidur Hai.
No. Yes. This is the old city here. And we're probably up here, Mount Scopus, Hebrew University. You are here, look, that's where you are. And this is called Zurim Valley National Park. What does Zurim mean?
Zur is like a rock.
A rock, uh-huh, thank you. Emek Zur.
Emek is valley.
Yeah.
National Park is...
Emek Zurim, uh-huh.
Yeah.
Zurim National Park. Okie doke. Well, here we go walking again. Shalom. So maybe we go this way. It's going to give us a more angle here. And, oh no, it doesn't go anywhere, does it? Let me see. Yeah, there's a path here. It continues. So this way we can get more of the old city view from here. So there we have the Dome of the Rock again. I see a very nice path there I'd like to walk along. Let's see if we can get to it. Maybe I'm up too high here. Yep, I'm not in the right place. Maybe we can go cross country. Let's go here. Just watch your step, people. There we are. So let's go to this path over there. I think that'll be a very nice walk. And we'll also keep a little more height, which is good for our view. So anyway, they're walking along with this stranger and they said, you know, this is amazing. And these women are saying that the tomb is empty, you know, they're still going home. They're abandoning Jerusalem. They're leaving. They're out of the picture. They're very sad, very disappointed. So he starts to talk about the prophets and about Moses, which means the Torah. So there's quite a lot of floral variety here. And afterwards, when they're commenting about this encounter, they say how our hearts went on fire when he was explaining the scriptures. And so he was explaining to them how the scriptures applied to him. And they were intrigued, amazed. And then It was getting late, and they said to them, "We're staying here, can't you come and stay with us, at least have supper with us?" So he accepted that part of the invitation. And in the breaking of the bread, which they let him do as the guest, they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. And what did they do? Tired after the long journey, they had new energy. And they hit the road again and come back to Jerusalem. And we're in a good place to see it, because they came back to the upper room where all the disciples were gathered. Right over there in the center of the screen. And when they came back, bursting with, the words were like bursting, ready to burst out of their mouth, they were met with triple bursting from the other side, that they already had seen the Lord. That Peter had seen him, that he has risen. Oh, look at these yellow flowers up here. I think we had these in Galilee a month ago. See, Jerusalem is much higher up, so it's colder, and spring is later here. This is a nice view of the Dome of the Rock. You'd never think you'd see the Dome of the Rock in the midst of such vegetation, or at the end of such vegetation, would you? Although the Temple Mount itself is filled with olive trees and pine trees. So let's line up this path with the Dome of the Rock there. Look at that. So then they get to tell their story finally. And this is the experience of the risen Lord. Look at all these flowers here. You remember we saw like carpets of flowers like this in Galilee. And they're just happening now in Jerusalem. Count all the different flowers, people. Just amazing. It's really nice, isn't it? In Galilee, okay, we have mountains and hills, and that's nice. It's countryside, but here, to be right beside Jerusalem, I only walked a half an hour to get to where I started the live stream from Notre Dame, and to have all this vegetation right there, so close. And the birds as well, they really got going this morning as the light emerged. The abundance of flower, of bloom. I often hiked here years and years ago, my first years in Jerusalem. We saw some of these already this morning, or liked them. I'm just intrigued by and amazed and delighted by the design of these flowers. The color schemes, the delicacy. And this is all growing wild here. And then the story of Peter in the temple. There are a lot of interesting comments to make there, that these disciples continue to go to the temple to pray. That's very interesting. And you know, life hasn't changed, and history hasn't changed, and humanity hasn't changed. So who do they meet at the temple but a person who is begging for help, for alms? Still meet these everywhere in the world. Years and years sitting there begging, asking for help, asking for compassion. And this man was crippled. So he couldn't work to survive, so he had to ask other people for help. And he was at the beautiful gate of the temple. Right now we're looking at this gate, right? It's replacement, it's... You see this double gate here, where the Messiah should enter according to Jewish tradition. And of course, seeing Peter and John with the energy that they are walking and filled with joy, the joy of the resurrection, he appeals to them, to their goodness. They were going to the temple area for the 3 o'clock hour of prayer. Guys, I don't know if you know this, but we still do that. It's called the Liturgy of the Hours. It's a praying of the Psalms in a very structured way that actually continues the prayer of the Psalms that was done for thousands of years. And those disciples were doing this, and Jesus surely did it, and he was living the tradition of his people, and they continued doing it, and it passed on into the Christian community. And right here in Jerusalem, there are dozens of Christian communities, and we're praying the Psalms every day. And not just in Jerusalem, all over the Holy Land, and not just all over the Holy Land, all over the Middle East, and not just all over the Middle East, but all over the whole world, from the tip of Chile to Alaska, from Japan and Korea, wrapping around all of Asia to here, on through Europe, and across the Atlantic Ocean, north and south, to the Americas, and across the islands and the Pacific, again to the west coast of the Americas. Non-stop praying of the Liturgy of the Hours. The Psalms are being lifted up always. The Psalms that were prayed here at the temple, David's Psalms. Just imagine. And they went at 3 o'clock, because there are different times. So that's the mid-afternoon prayer that we have in the breviary. We have a midday prayer, a mid-morning prayer. We have Lauds in the early morning, and Vespers in the evening, a night prayer called Compline also, and then an Office of Readings, which can be done anytime. And then what did the Muslims do? They saw this praying tradition and they continued it in their times of prayer. So this is just a very interesting detail. There's so much in that fact. So this crippled man asked for alms in front of the beautiful gate of the temple. And he saw Peter and John, he asked them. And Peter looked intently at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." He paid attention to them, expecting to receive something from them. Peter said, "I have neither silver nor gold, but what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, rise and walk." Then Peter took him by the right hand and raised him up. And he started walking and jumping and praising God. People were filled with astonishment. Hey, I think the sun is up. You can see the color hitting on the dome of the rock. You can see a little shine coming there. The sun is beginning to hit it, so we didn't get to see the sun in its original sunrise, but there it is now. Maybe if we go around the corner here, we might see it. But maybe not. There's too much of a corner here. Well, you can see the growing intensity of the light, but I don't think we're going to make it to get to see the light there. So people, I want to say thank you for joining us this morning. This was quite the morning here in Jerusalem. It's always a joy to have you along. And I'll be heading back to Notre Dame, which is way over there. Let me show you. It's right there in the center of the screen to the right of the Franciscan Tower in front of those two big high rises. Look, you can see the two towers of Notre Dame. So God bless you. See you later, alligators. It's been great to be with you. God bless you all.